You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and in a little bit of a change up, we've done road trip episodes, we've done interviews with wrestlers, with ring announcers, with commentators, and everything in between. For the first time, we're going down the charity route, and what better way to do that is speak to the new charity on the scene that's dedicated to giving everyone a chance to get to know a bit more about wrestling, and also benefit their own lives at the same time. I'm joined by Dan, Ross. Thankfully, they've got names on their hoodies there. So if you're watching the video version, fantastic. Dan Ross from the Hot Tag Foundation. Welcome to the show.
Hello, lovely to be on. Ross is the one with the Scottish accent, I guess, for the listeners.
And Dan's the one with the Yorkshire accent. So I apologise if you can't understand me.
Sorry, if they can't get through the Scottish accent, they've got no chance. They would have stopped by now, so we'll be all good. You probably got the clearest accent out of the three of us. We're going to talk about the Hot Tag Foundation, and it's a little bit different for myself as an interviewer, because usually I can just rely on just going, how did you get into wrestling? We'll do that. But you get into wrestling, oh, you're a wrestler. Sweet. We'll do a little bit about that with Ross, of course, because he's got his own Wilson way going on with his alter ego, with his cousin, we like to call it, on the show. But Dan, you're the head honcho of this operation, the Hot Tag Foundation. So before we get into the actual nitty gritty, the meat and potatoes of the charity itself, how did you become a fan of professional wrestling?
My fandom started in 2008, 16 long years ago for me. And I've loved every moment of it, even through the 2013 era, the Thunderdome era, which I'm pretty sure was a blip that I do not remember any of it, but I somehow loved it. But you know, it was Royal Rumble 2008 was my first ever chance of watching.
That's a first.
I hardly was the reason I started watching it. But yeah, back in 2008, I loved watching the Rumble. You know, it was a Royal Rumble for me was the perfect introduction to wrestling, because it's just you get to meet all new superstars. Past superstars, and you know, it's just you get to choose, take your pick on whatever. And fortunately for me, Jeff Hardy stood out for me. So I remember being at school and some kids having slam attacks, and just looking at them thinking, "Wow, this looks amazing! I want to be so invested in this." Because I wasn't a big football kid. I was a little bit of a rugby kid, but you know, I think I craved something a bit more. And then once pro wrestling came across my desk, it was a That was it. I was fully invested. I was ready to go. But I wanted all the toys. I wanted the belts. I wanted everything in between. I wanted, and you know, I think for me that was the perfect time to get into it, especially as a Jeff Hardy fan, because I got to live the whole year, and then culminate at Armageddon where I finally won the WWE title. So I think that was, you know, the storytelling of that was what really made me fall in love with pro wrestling.
I was just about to say, because yeah, that as a fellow Jeff Hardy fan, and I'm a little bit older, so I started in 99-ish, to see him, that start of the year, 2008, so that was him versus Randy Orton, with the Twist of Fate counter, did the RKO, getting called Jeff Harvey, and then John Cena coming back in the Royal Rumble, then Armageddon at the end of the year. Yeah, that was some time to be a Jeff Hardy fan. Like you're saying, Royal Rumble is the perfect event for fans, because not even a WWE base, but just from an indie base as well. I always say, if you're going to go to a first show, pick a Rumble. It's easy to digest the rules. It's very, yeah, you see all these faces, you get the characters. It's over the top rope, 2 feet hit the floor, last one standing wins. How just easy to digest is that? For yourself, Ross, how did you get into
it? So mine was kind of an accident. Like, I remember when Bravo was a thing, watching World's Strongest Man with my brother, and then staying up to watch TNA after it. And my brother loved TNA growing up, and he loved wrestling and stuff. So we used to just sit up, and like it was the one night a week during the school week that I could stay up late, because I think it was on like a Thursday or something. So we'd sit and we'd watch TNA, and then I remember just loving AJ Styles, and I was like, yeah, he's my favorite. And then eventually, I think my auntie bought us tickets to a live show once, and I was desperate to see AJ Styles, and it was like 2013 where he left the company a week before. So I kind of got stiffed with that one. So that was kind of what got me into it. I just never grew out of it really. And then 2019, I finally met AJ and got to see him live, and I was like, this is good. I feel like this is the end of a cycle.
That's amazing. So I like that you've both come from similar years ish, like 5 years in between, but it's two different, absolute different side of the coin. WWE for yourself, Dan, and then TNA or Impact Wrestling for Ross. It just shows that wrestling is so universal that it, as long as you like it, people will just go, I'll speak about wrestling with you. Why not? It doesn't matter.
I think one good thing to note about our team as well is that going off from what you just said there, is that there's also, barring me and Ross as well, there's also my friend, our friend Nathan, who watched it in the Attitude Era, and then my best friend Jonathan, who's our rep for the Yorkshire. Me and him got into it at the same time, and then there's my wife Laura, who got into it in 2021, like when we first started seeing each other. And it's like, you know, we've all come from different, you know, introductions to wrestling, but they all have the same passion behind them, and that's just, you know, and we all have the same passion for giving back in the same thing. So creating this team was unbelievably difficult because we wanted to make sure it was the right team, and then including Dalton as well as our youth ambassador, who is the biggest Edge fan you'll ever meet in your entire life, and he's 14. And we were talking about yesterday on the A to the K podcast that I remember him getting retweeted by Bleacher Report because he cried because Edge won the Royal Rumble on his birthday. And that, to me, just, you know, solidified the love of pro wrestling as a child. And that's what we wanted to capture and what we're trying to do. So, like I say, coming from different eras is just important in the way we can target different demographics and different people. That's important for us.
I did have a look at your team on Instagram. You did the profiles of people getting into it and what their favorite eras was, and you're right, it's such a mix of I mean, for yourself, I think you said the Renaissance era being the time, which is where we're in now, kind of thing, and Ross, yourself, I can't remember offhand what it was, but just the mix of your team having that. I mean, for myself, I would like to say I would love to say Attitude Era, but I would probably into the Ruthless Aggression era before I properly got hold of wrestling, just post 2001. But yeah, that's exactly what you're saying. It means that everyone's got a corner covered when it comes to wrestling in itself. So let's talk about Hot Tag Foundation, because that's what we're really here for. We will tangent away, I'm sure. If you mention a wrestler, I'll probably ask more questions about them. But this is what we need to speak about, because this is what's happening in August up until December, is the first annual Toil Rumble. So before we get to that bit, Hot Tag Foundation, I found out a little bit more when we did our little chat before SWN became a supporter of the Hot Tag Foundation. But if one of you want to take the lead and talk about the inception, the concept behind the Hot Tag Foundation.
I don't mind going into the inception. It's a bit of a backstory. Me and Ross met a couple of years ago, about 4 years ago, when I was doing a similar project locally. That has since been disbanded, I believe. And I left, unfortunately, at that time. But Ross was our biggest donor at that time. And we'd never met before in our entire life. We'd met through, I believe it was a Facebook group, where it was like, I want to get involved. And honestly, the box that we got from Scotland, from Ross, might have covered the whole country from what we got. So it was unbelievable to see, and the generosity that it showed, just by just total strangers that we was just trying to get out there and trying to do something nice. And it was, you know, it was unbelievable to see. So unfortunately, after we split ways previously, me and Ross stayed in touch. You know, we've been really good friends the past 4 years. And then, you know, we've all done our stuff in the time. Ross, a graduate of Strathclyde University, I'm a graduate of the Hull University. Me and my partner got married earlier in the year, in February, and you know, once April came around, I was hungry to keep doing something and do something else, and this was something that had a huge impact on me when I first did it. And locally, we managed to distribute about 60 boxes locally, tailored bespoke boxes to superstars, to individuals, you know, little notes that we could include, etc. And I was so ready to take that further. Unfortunately, it wasn't taken at the time, but I knew what I wanted to do, and I knew the team that I wanted to form to be able to take it nationally. And I think that's what we've done. We've done quite well so far. We've hit Yorkshire, we've hit Lancashire, and we've hit in Scotland respectively as well. So taking it national was very important. When April came along, finding the name was probably one of the hardest parts, because everything was taken. I remember dropping messages to everyone like, I like this idea. I want to be called Champions for Change. Oh, there's somewhere in London that's got that. I want to be called this. Oh, they've copyrighted this. We can't do that. And, you know, the metaphor just kind of wrote itself, really, once you start speaking about, you know, forming a team, hitting that hot tag. And sometimes it's just about reaching out for that tag and making sure you've got someone supporting you there. And once you finally get that tag, you're back in form, you're back in shape. And that's what we wanted to make sure, that the whole metaphor on the Hot Tag Foundation, you know, surrounded it. So, and you know, when that came around the punchline, you've just got to reach out came out, and it was like a domino effect. We all just bounced ideas off each other constantly, all of us, and it was so beautiful to watch and watch it form. And from there, May, we was very out. Well, I especially was very important in the fact that I wanted to make sure we had a foundation. We had a solid foundation of people who actually wanted to support us and wanted us to succeed. Because if we wanted to, unfortunately, there has been, over the past couple of years, there has been a few negative incidents in British wrestling, and we want to show that there is positivity out there, and we can be, you know, a platform for positivity. So from that, we wanted to make sure people can trust us, put faces to names, have podcasts, have meetings. We was on constant calls with people, like promoters, with talent, with whoever we can reach out and just say, this is who we are. We're genuine people. We're not trying to, like, we don't try to do anything. We're genuine people, and we're ready to support. That's it from me. The formation was brilliant, fantastic. Ross, I don't know about you. I know when I came to you with the idea, yeah. I know you were straight on board, straight like.
So you literally messaged me a photo of a tag happening, and I was like, right, what's this? What are you up to? And then as soon as you explained it to me, I was like, yeah, let's do it. Like, again, I was at a point where I'm kind of not really knowing what I'm doing next in terms of my sort of life in general. So I was like, yeah, let's do it. Give me something to bite my teeth into. And it all happened very, very quickly. And I literally bought a ticket the day before Clash at the Castle and decided that I was going to go out and do a bunch of promotion there for this, and chuck my blue hoodie on and go and hand out stickers and cards and stuff. And it's just spiraled since then, which is wild. Like, it's taken off so quickly that I can't really... It's mental to think that a couple of months ago, Dan was sending cryptic Instagram messages.
Yeah, it's like a lot. I got a lot of inspiration from Bray Wyatt back then, doing kind of like cryptic things, and maybe I should have done for a children's charity. But hey, it was something that wrestling fans we knew loved, like adding coordinates, adding, you know, binary code of our name and stuff. Like, it was just but that was, you know, it was very important to us. But yeah,
obviously, like, a couple of years ago, that massive donation, like, it kind of. As soon as you explained that a couple of years ago, I was like, yeah, this guy's okay. This guy's sound. Like, we can be friends, given, like, the amount of stuff you did in that other place that was wild. And obviously, I chucked down a massive amount of toys from me and Manny. So it was like, the postage on that was a fortune. I dread to think what it would cost now. But it was a case of, like, over a couple of days, we just went out and we went to, like, A1 Toys. We went to as many sort of places as we could. And we went, okay, let's just buy everything you have that's, like, half cheap.
That was my next follow-up question. We were saying Ross was the biggest donor to the cause, the initial cause, before Hot Tag Foundation was. So what inspired you to just do it? Just to go, right, screw this, Auntie, we're going to go and... buy all these toys and.
Well, I think at the time, it was during COVID, I'm sure. So there was a lot of, like, firstly, I had a lot of extra money because I wasn't going out in the piss. So Yeah, I had to put that money somewhere. But also, like, a lot of people were struggling at that time, and obviously I was doing sort of reasonably well. You know, I was at uni, I was making enough money and everything. Like, I was doing all right financially. So I was like, well, you know, if I'm not going to spend this money going out, I may as well put it somewhere, because if I don't, I'm just going to buy rubbish. So we went out in an afternoon, we just went, right, let's just buy as many toys as we can and then figure out how we're going to send this. Because we came home with, like, bags of stuff from the boot, and we're like, oh my God, we've got a boot full of toys. How on earth are we going to send these to England? Like, it was an interesting one. And then, like I said, I knew from the start, sometimes you just get that feeling with people, you're like, yeah, this is worth doing. Let's help out.
I just laughed at your thing there, saying, otherwise you just buy a load of crap. And
yeah, pretty much. Like,
you know, if anyone watches the first few podcasts, I was
a student who couldn't go drinking. I had so much extra disposable to just, you know.
I know. Well, I did this podcast 4 years. Well, started this 4 years ago. June, I started it 4 years ago. And I look at the background, and I have three pops, and two of which are, I think two of them are out of the box, and that's about it. That's all I have in the background. That and the belts. I've had the belts for.
Oh, and I remember at the time as well. I bought John Cena's book like 8 times, and his team email was saying, because you bought a book, you get like a free sort of cameo style video, and I'm like 20. I'm 20 years old. I don't need a cameo from John Cena. What is going on, like? So I sent them an email back, and I just said, can you just shout these guys out, please? Like, that would do a whole lot more good than you saying happy birthday to somebody that I don't even like. So please just shout them out. And then within like half an hour, his team had emailed me back going, oh yeah, here it is. So that was a nice bit of promo for
it really was, to be fair, because like I say, we wasn't, at the time, we weren't expecting a lot. It was during COVID, which was, I think it may have helped during the time, because people wanted to make sure they're giving back as well as what they could actually afford and what they could do. I don't know, like what Ross said, it really resonated with people, that people wanted to, like, you know, still show support for British wrestling and to get people involved in wrestling, and we could have been, we was that support network. And then when it came to Ross doing the donation and stuff like that, we posted them on Facebook. It was like, look at this huge box from Scotland. And I think the British just went, you know what, we can beat that. We're going to send more donations. And then we just got loads more. And then Ross sent the video of John Cena doing the shout out. And then more people got involved. And it was like, what? And cameos were huge back then. So we got like Dominic Dijakovic to do a cameo and stuff like that when he was like trying to make some money during NXT. And like, you know, people clicked onto that so well. Like, it was a £30 cameo, but it drove so many donations. It was very important. So Ross was I don't mean to toot his horn, but Ross was a massive integral.
I'm going to have a beam or something. This is
what we did. So you know, like I said, it was very important that me and Ross stayed in touch. And I think it's worth noting as well that me and Ross didn't meet each other for the first time until last year.
Yeah, like, literally. So we were like friends for years, and then we finally met at Money in the Bank last year, which was lovely.
In London, of all places, when you're up here in Scotland, and I'm here in the middle of, we meet right down here. It's,
yeah.
Magical. It brings how wrestling brings people together. It's magical. It really is.
You mentioned John Cena then, and do you think, because it only took him like half an hour or so for his team to send that email, organize the shout out, send it back, is that something that kind of inspires you to keep? I mean, because it's John Cena. He's done what, 500 make a wishes or something like that. He's constantly seems to be busy. And yet, half an hour later, he had a video all sorted and done and shouted out and just done. Is that inspiration for you guys just to keep working at Hot Tag Foundation, just to keep making sure that you're doing the absolute best? Because if John Cena can do it, then what's stopping us or yourselves certainly from just making sure that people are getting the best experience as possible?
100%. And John Cena was a massive inspiration to a lot of us. Because of his work that he does, and you know, he's constantly, you know, he's a very selfless person, and that's who we are. We are selfless people, and we're just trying to, you know, show that we can be, we are reliable people, we are trustworthy people, and you know, we are just trying to do good. And John was a huge inspiration to what we were trying to do. Even the conception of the foundation was very much based on John Cena's abilities and what he's been able to do during his busy schedule. And we all have, you know, we all have jobs, we all have like some important jobs, we have kids, we have families, but it was important that we make sure we give back to something that was given us so much. And that's what John Cena lives by, is that he wants to give back to wrestling, because it's given him, you know, it's given him a life, it's given him a career, it's given him fortune, fame, and he's just constantly wanting to give back. So the best way to answer that question is John Cena is maybe the biggest inspiration, barring Edge, actually, because Edge is since he came back from his the Rumble, he did some work for us as well when we was doing it before, and he did a video for Dalton, and we did like a live Zoom call with Edge, Adam Copeland, during COVID and stuff like that. And me and Dalton met him in Cardiff because he was so excited to meet us and stuff like that. It was, you know, it's having that time out of such a busy schedule. It's like, why can't we do it? We can do this easily. We do it on night time. We can do it whenever. And we are. That's what we're doing. We text each other during work, and then we'll come home and like we'll just think things to post, things to send out, ideas, the Toilet Rumble idea. Like, we just fly all the time. The beautiful thing about what we're trying to do is that there's so many dimensions to it, and there's so many ways that we can go, that our mission statement can constantly change, because we go from targeting young people to targeting adults and mental health, and that's, you know, with so many cool ideas that we can do after the first year. This first year is about gaining trust and gaining that reliability on us, and, you know, make sure people understand that we're just trying to be that support network. And then next year, the sky's the absolute limit. Absolute limit.
So let's talk about the donation drive and get that in before we spiral off and start talking about nonsense elsewhere. So it's the first annual Toil Rumble. It's a donation drive. It started now, as of when this episode goes out, which will be August 5th. So people will already be well aware if they're following the Hot Tang Foundation on Instagram or on social media in general. You've got plenty of rules, so I'm going to read them so people know all about them, but they can go on to Instagram and find out more if they so wish, which they should, because it's just a charity. Even if you can't donate, a share, a like, exposing the world to this is always a good thing. So the rules of the Rumble. I'm so used to saying Royal Rumble because, you know, I'm a wrestling fan for 25 years. Rules of the Rumble. Please send all donations to the premises of Real Wrestling. That's FAO Hot Tag Foundation, Anchor Storage, New Road, Dudley, DY29 Alpha Foxtrot. I think, see, I work in insurance, so I know the phonetic alphabet. Rules of the Rumble 2. Donations will only be accepted between August 1st, which we're way past, so, you know, get sorted, and December 1st to allow us time to sanitize and pack the items in time for drop-offs. These will then be distributed by Hot Tag Foundation to locations, charities, and families during the holiday season. This is going very well. I thought I'd stumble over words by now. Rules of the Rumble 3. We accept both new and toys. Damn it. I jinxed myself right there. We accept both new and used toys, merchandise, stationery, books, trading cards, figures, and pop vinyl stickers. That's not right. I've absolutely screwed up. Pop vinyl, stickers, posters, 8x10s, clothing, fidgets, sensory toys, etc. Please DM us if you have any donation queries. And by us, I mean Hot Tag Foundation, not me. I will not be any helpful, but I will try and direct you to the right place. Rules of number 4. Any tag... I can't believe I said that. I was doing well. I'm glad I'm a professional. Any items deemed inappropriate that may bring negative exposure or could pose a risk to young people will be dismissed or returned respectfully. I dread to think what you could receive. Rule 5, we encourage you to add a personalised note with your donations that explains pro wrestling means to you. Ah, typo. That's for you guys. That explains pro wrestling means to you, why you're donating, and a bit about your favourite superstars. These may be assigned to tailored boxes. 6, two more. If you are unable to donate due to financial constraints, like I said, please do not feel obliged. We also accept donations of your time by just supporting us, like the podcasters are doing. And if you'd like to nominate a child, family, or charity to receive one of the donations, please do get in touch. You've just got to reach out. Hot Tag Foundation, first ever Toil Rumble. That went almost well.
I say you did that.
Smashed it.
So, beautiful. When it comes to this, so you've had the charity endeavours. Ross has bought out most of A1 toys in the past to donate to these causes. My biggest question is going to be, is there anything you've received that you're like, oh my god, this is incredible? We've mentioned the cameos, which is incredible in itself, but has there been something that's passed by you that you've went, oh, that's going to make someone's world, that's going to make someone's life if they receive this? In the back of your mind going, really wish I want that myself, but you know, it's charity. But yeah, has there been anything that you spotted that's been like, oh my god?
What, previously? I
guess just through your charity endeavours.
The first time we received a hell of a lot of pop vinyls, but there was a majority were the same pop vinyls. There was plenty of Trishes, plenty of Charlottes, Naomi's that were Chases, like Chase Glow in the Dark Naomi's, which I was dying for at the time because I was like big, huge pop collector. I've since stopped collecting pop vinyls. I've got way too many. But like just stuff like that's been absolutely mental. Like we received a 4-foot Hulk Hogan. I don't know what he wanted us to do with that at the time. I don't think we give it out at that point, to be fair. I think we returned it, if I'm completely honest. Because
yes, yeah,
all right. But yeah, just like just stuff like that. Like the opportunity we had with Edge before was incredible. Like meeting Edge was even more incredible. My claim to fame is that I had a 5-second pose with Edge, and that's just,
you know, I saw the video of that. Yeah,
brave. But we had tons of Bray Wyatt merchandise back in that day as well. And now we've not received any donations as of yet, barring what we've got from our partners at Real Wrestling, who sent us an absolute shed load of, you know, wristbands, notebooks, like just things that kids would love, like stocking fillers, box fillers, as you will. And then we've had people reach out saying we want to donate clothes, we want to donate t-shirts, like it's just constantly at us now. So it's great to see. And we're just trying to make sure we can navigate and make sure it's like they'll come to us and say, oh, we've got a big F Endure t-shirt. Would you like one of those? And like, yeah, it sounds great. Just not the one that says, you know, the full effing word. It's like, yeah, cool. We can look into it. We can advise them. We've got a great team. Like we've got safeguarding people on our team. We've got, like, you know, it's really good. But from what I can remember, it was a lot of toys. And I can't remember a lot of it. All I remember was me full to the brim in PPE, cleaning toys, like looking at them. And I think the more that toys that we got, the more I was like, I used to have this figure. I used to have this one. Oh, this is great. This, I had like Eddie Guerrero figures, and I'm a huge Eddie fan. Like I've got, you're not the only one with an undisputed title. I've got mine here, actually. My undisputed title. Like,
it continues our streak. I've had so many episodes this season that people have had, wrestlers have had their belts on, and I like that we've ticked that off again. Oh, very nice.
That's fine. So like Eddie's my guy. Eddie and Jeff are my guys, and like seeing all this stuff come through, I'm like, oh, do you know what? It's better in someone else's hands than my hands. So
yeah, no, listen, I am gonna try my absolute hardest between now and like the end of November to beat the last donation like tenfold. You know, every time I'm out, I'm gonna try and buy like one small thing, hopefully, and then just take it from there, and then be like, at the end of November, hopefully have like a room full of stuff and just be like, okay, how am I going to send this?
Do you know what? I wouldn't put it past you. I would not put it past you at all.
Like, again, I've said to my auntie, I was like, if you go out and you see like a wrestling thing under like a tenner or a fiver, if you've got a couple of spare quid on you, please pick it up.
and that's important to go off, like rule number 6, I believe it was. If you are unable to donate, do not feel obligation to donate, because the more that we go out, like just looking everywhere, I don't remember wrestling figures being £28 at all.
Yeah.
Like, I do not remember that at all. This is why I was like, yeah, if it's used, send it us, we'll clean it. It does the same thing. Like, unless you're a collector, you don't need to keep it in a box. If you're a kid, you want to play with it, that's fine, that's cool. Do not spend £28 10 times to donate it. You know, we'd rather have the £250 on smaller items, but whatever, or to yourself to make sure you're keeping life afloat. Like, don't feel obligated. Your time is very important to us. Support is very important to us in our inaugural year, especially. And then once 2025 comes out of it, then we'll just smash it out of the park again. Yeah. It'll be a full year of donations instead of for 4 months. It's going to be so long.
Good touch to your point there. Yeah, I remember back in my day, where VHSs were £15.99 if we were lucky. Figures were about that, £12. £10, £12, and you get a pretty cool figure, bone crunching action. I don't know if I'm just speaking to into the ether of young people when I'm mentioning these figures, but they were just like silicon plastic, and then you pop them and they cracked at their elbows and their knees. They're incredible. That's the cost then. I've went into shops recently and seen these collectible, these £28 figures. And I'm like, who are these for? Because they're not for kids. All the small parts and all that kind of thing. It's just...
They're for people like us, apparently, because we keep buying them.
I know. I want to be a wrestler. This is, again, another theme through the season is I want to be a wrestling figure guy. I just don't have the space, time, or money to be a wrestling figure guy. So I'm a trading card guy now. And you know what? Trading cards are cool. You can go, you can get a trading card, take them to a show. There's British wrestling ones going around if you look in the right places, and you can go to a show, get them signed, and that's a rookie card. Like, that's such a cool thing to
that
have.
Is cool.
And yeah, also takes up hell of a less room as well, which is very nice. But that's unbelievable. But yeah, like you're saying, if you're not, don't pay £28 for a figure. Maybe go to Smith's or something, pick up a couple for a fiver, and that'll do just as much good to the cause than because at the same time, like you're saying, these £28 figures, they've got small parts. You're not going to really want to put them into boxes for children, because that's just a liability in itself.
And the size of packaging these days as well, like the size of what we're getting put in, like, for example, I've got this Jeff Hardy Ultimate figure here. That's going to take up all of my box, like when we create boxes. And it's like, this is why I use one. We can put more stuff into them. And it's like, you know, we can fit 5-6 figures into a box where you'd fit one that's packaged. And, you know, you get the safety of a package that is, you know, it's never been touched, it's never been whatever. But leave that to us. We're happy to clean it. We're happy to sanitize it, make sure it's ready for distribution. Like, we can isolate it for 2 weeks like we did previously. Like, with so many guidelines that we've put in place already, that it's just like, doesn't matter if it's used. As long as it's not been, you know, smacked, like, it's got blood all over it, or, like, it's you know, missing a head, maybe we'll put that in the box. But, like, if it's, like, a regular figure that's intact and it looks fine, you know, it may not mean something to you, but to a kid, that's a role model in their hands that they can look up to, search on the internet, watch the videos. Like, it's unbelievable that these days, the access that they would have, there's wrestling on every day of the week, every social media platform, constantly, boom, 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 wrestling, wrestling, wrestling. It's like, you know, once you find that guy, it's brilliant. Like, I relied on dirt sheets when I was little, and I hated the fact that I used to rely on dirt sheets, because I was very much like, oh, I'm so excited to watch the show. But I kind of know what's kind of happening now. Like, it was like to me, it was like a soap opera. It was like Emmerdale or EastEnders or something, but with big dudes fighting each other. It's, you know, what's not to love about it?
If you see me, in Scotland anywhere reading a car boot sale, don't give me the look. You know, that's my sort of plan for the donation, is just go and raid car boot sales at this point.
Like, it's going to be you, just like there going,
if anybody does, I know postage is extortionate, so if there's the first couple of donations from Scotland, message me and I'll send you a couple of quid for the postage.
Boot sales, I love a boot sale. It's like, for that reason, because I like to find, like, last time I went to a boot sale, see if I can grab it without causing absolute carnage in the shelf here. But I've got one of these bad boys.
Class.
And there was loads of them. Well, I mean, I've got an actual replica as well, WWF branded. But I saw this and I was like, I need this.
Class.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, that was my belt when I was younger. I loved these belts, like the Jack's firm belt.
Saying that, I feel left out now. I've got a TNA one upstairs, but
that was my belt when I was younger.
We can keep going. I'm happy.
I'll keep going.
I've got the big TNA six player. I think that was one that I bought during lockdown. I had to break a few lockdown rules to get, but.
I don't want to show off on this one, but it's signed by Hacksaw Jim Duggan and Billy Gunn, you know.
I don't condone breaking rules to get wrestling belts, but
I do not either. I don't sound convincing at all in that statement.
To be fair, I think I beat all of you. To be fair, I have a wrestling belt with my married name, or well, my me and my
wife. Tremendous.
Well done. Well done.
But anyway, that's on our Hot Tag Foundation page. Go find it. It's a pretty cool belt.
I was going to pull out the European belt that I've got signed by DDP, but I think yours has got more sentimental value than that. You've kind of trumped me there. Not even the Hurricane. No, it's still still win. So that tangent aside, you talked about inspiration and getting an action figure and like that could be someone's guy going forward. Speaking of someone's guy, someone on this podcast is a bit of a wrestler themselves, as we mentioned near the start. So, Ross, how did your cousin Mike get into training to be a pro wrestler?
So, God, I had a bit of it. So, I think it was sort of end of 2022, and I was sort of going through this sort of personal development loop that had started January that year. And it was basically a big sort of life overhaul where I was like, I better get myself together, because I can't keep going like this. And Dan was obviously a huge part of that, being such good friends, but he kept me going at a point where it was tough, you know? So at the end of that year, I was kind of like, well, I played a lot of tennis at uni and I wanted to go into something that was slightly different when I finished uni. And I was like, well, I can't just start something new when I finish tennis, because then there's not like, I need to give myself a couple of months to kind of get used to something, and then I've got somewhere to go after. So I signed up to a WrestleFit class with Girders, and the first one was Levi taking it. I remember I just went in and I was like, this is hard, but that was class. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Levi's insane. He put us through our paces, and it was like no impact stuff. And I remember him saying to me at the time, you know, we do one-to-ones here. Like, if you're interested kind of thing, we do sort of private training. And I was like, yeah, let's give that a go. So I went in, did a couple of private sessions, and I was like, this is good fun. Like, this is really good fun. So I think I've found my thing that's next. And obviously when Girders decided they were going to open a gym in February that year, like the training school, straight away I was like, okay, let's see what I've got. Let's give it a go. And yeah, just it spiraled from there. It's gone mega from there, you know, and like the people at Girders have been very, very good to me in the way that they've trained me. So I'm grateful for the opportunity to train there as well. And like, I've been to seminars with like Rampage Brown and stuff. It's just spiraled so quickly in like a year. And the fact that it could sort of continue the personal development loop that I'd been sort of going on at the time anyway, it was so cool, because I'm like, okay, now I've got better mentally, now let's try and get better physically, and let's merge the two together. And then that's kind of where the whole sort of Mike Wilson character came from, was like, I had a coach and while I was going through this sort of personal development loop, and I remember doing a dissertation on this coach, and the dissertation advisor said, he is, and she proceeded to call him every name under the sun. Like, she thought he was the absolute worst person ever, right? Obviously, I loved him because I resonated with him and he was my coach, but she just seen right past him. And I remember going in and it was a promo class. So I was like, what if I just take bits from this coach and see what happens? And I kind of merged Mike Wilson into sort of me, but then with a lot of this coach who this teacher hated. And I went, maybe that'll work. So that's kind of where Mike Wilson came from. It was just like, let's try and merge something that somebody who I personally love and I take a lot from, but a lot of people don't like, and let's just turn them up and see. And I told the coach this when I was still working with him. I was like, you know, you've just inspired this entire like character that people are supposed to despise. And he was like, yeah, that sounds about right.
I mean, you merged that as well with the Wilson Way mantra as well, a little bit with that John Cena tweet energy that he gives off as well. Was that again something that you maybe brought into the mentality, not just maybe not for your in-ring character work, but certainly for your social media content?
I think I was just looking for a bit of alliteration, to be honest with you. And we were brainstorming names with me and Manny for weeks and googling names and being like, okay, does that work? No, that doesn't work either. And you know, that's stuff was trademarked and everything already, the same kind of issue Dan had with Hot Tag. And it got to the point where I was like, do you know what? Let's just use my real name and hope for the best. And then that's kind of where Wilson Way came about. And I just decided that I was going to try and... The goal when I'm posting content, at least on my social media, is to sort of make stuff that at the time where I was really struggling, I would look at and go, okay, I can take something from that. Like, it might be sort of shrouded and hidden within sort of me being me, but me trying to be nasty, but there's always sort of some kind of lesson that you can take away from any of the content that I try and post. And it's always sort of lessons that I've learned while going on this personal development loop. And I think it's quite cool that, like, while I'm going on that journey, there's an opportunity that I get new insights along the way as well that I can share with other people and be like, you know, I didn't know this before I started wrestling, but now I do.
Dan, have you ever had an interest? Have you ever trained, or are you quite happy to be on our side of the barrier?
I always wanted to be a wrestler. Unfortunately, I have spina bifida occulta, which means I have a hole in my spine, which makes it more fragile, which I don't think any wrestling company would touch me, insurance-wise. So, unfortunately, never got the opportunity to. I wanted to start writing. I've always been a passionate writer. I've always wanted to get into writing storylines and all that kind of stuff, but the time never seemed right to be able to get into it. And I studied business at university instead of, like, as a blanket, instead of studying literacy and English. So, but, you know, dreams can happen. We'll see. That's, and yeah. If Ross has taught me anything, and if Mike's taught me anything, that you just got to believe in the Wilson way and get yourself there.
Ah, stop putting me over. That's too nice. But another thing as well that not a lot of people know is, see all the branding for the Wilson way? It all came very stupidly from a pair of shoes. So when I was really going through it, like, I was really bad. I remember going on a night out with, like, the people that I knew from tennis already, and it was, like, the first time that I'd sort of gone outside after, like, a lot of stuff had happened. And I was wearing these shoes that were, like, they're the most bright-coloured, obscene shoes you can find, right? Like, a pair of Jordans that I paid a lot of money for, and I was like, do you know what? If anything's going to make me feel confident, these will, because you just, there was a certain feeling that I had when I put these on, and I was like, okay, I'm going to wear these shoes. These will bring me back to life, you know? And I went out, and people were making comments all night about the trainers. So me being sort of closed in at the time, it got me back out pretty quickly, and I was like, well, this is amazing. I made a lot of new friends really quickly on the back of a pair of trainers, which sounds mental. So when I was doing the Wilson Way stuff, I was like, I need to pay tribute to this in some way, because I wouldn't be sitting here doing this podcast. I wouldn't be here right now if it wasn't for something as trivial as a pair of shoes.
a night out with your tennis pals, I bet you love that.
What?
Yeah.
I see what you did there. Yeah.
Absolutely terrible. I made such a deuce of that.
I went and got... this was silly. I messaged Steve the Shoeman when I was getting my gear made and everything. And I was like, mate, can you just make... Because I can't wear the Jordans in the ring, because I need something to protect my ankle after I broke it last year. So I messaged Steve the Shoeman, a guy that makes boots online, and I was like, mate, can you just make me a pair of shoes that look like these? Because I want to have that confidence that I have when I wear those shoes out and about. And I wore the shoes again to graduation as well, which was insane. Like, walking across the stage, everybody's wearing brogues, and I'm wearing these, like, obnoxiously coloured bright green and blue trainers. It was wild. And I messaged him. I was like, can you make me boots, like wrestling boots, that look like these shoes? And he was like, yeah, 100%. And, like, within 3 weeks, I was like, oh my God, they're amazing. So every time I step out, like, I've got that piece of, like, this dragged me out when I was really, really struggling, and, like, something stupid as a pair of shoes that a lot of people don't know the sort of story of. They helped me, they dragged me out of this rut that I was in.
And they helped you, like, serve and be a more confident person. That actually leads me directly into speaking a bit independent wrestling. You mentioned Big F and Joe earlier, Dan, and we've mentioned Aaron Girders as well. How have you found contacting these companies? Is there any particular companies that have maybe went the extra mile above and beyond that been able to? I know Tidal has been one of them, but has been any companies that have properly just taken on the tag, that have reached their hand out and maybe stung a little bit when they've slapped your hand a bit too hard to get involved?
Tidal, I will happily, you know, their name was on the tip of my tongue as soon as you asked that question. Tidal Wrestling, the team there were unbelievably supportive. They was constantly messaging us and how can we get involved? We want to give you free tickets. Try and give these free tickets away. Want you to come to our show. Come to our show. And it was inspiring. That title of wrestling was one of our hugest like motivators to get out there, because it was like, can we give you this? Can we give you these? Can you help? Like, can we help you out? Kind of thing. It was just so unbelievable and so open to our ideas as well. So title of wrestling, definitely one of them. Off the page, pro wrestling. They're a new starter company. They've had one show already in May, and they've got one coming up next week in Warrington that me and Ross are going to be attending as well, which is really, really exciting because it means that we can, you know, we get to meet up again for the second time ever. And then, well, Salford City Wrestling, another new starter that's starting in October. It was very much like the smaller guys really wanted to get involved in what we're doing, and we definitely wanted to reach out to those people because when it comes to like the larger promotions, a lot of them were aimed more of a higher demographic in age. So TNT, Extreme Wrestling was definitely aged higher. Progress is a bit of a higher range when it comes to like No Mercy Wrestling in Scotland, in Wales, Salford City Wrestling, and Kingdom Wrestling as well. I don't know if you've ever heard of Kingdom Wrestling as well. They were on the BBC with some comedians a couple of months ago, and now they're a registered charity who've integrated, I believe, and I'm sure Gareth will quote me if I'm wrong, but they were trying to get more people into the church, and Gareth was like, let's put on a wrestling show. And it just kind of worked, and it worked really well, and is like really adapted this whole idea of it's a charity, a registered charity, now we can go and do this and do this and do this. It's so inspiring, and Kingdom Wrestling are going to be one of our hugest supporters and partners as well, in the fact that they've got great access that we can use as a support network where we can collect the donations and then link that through Kingdom to reach local hospitals as well. I think with the charity, the registered charity link from that, it's a lot easier for, you know, bigger companies or hospitals to trust us. At the minute, we're not looking to be a registered charity because we can't. It's a lot of commitment. There's a lot of money that you've got to put into this endeavour, which none of us have at the moment. We don't have the time. We don't have the money. And we're just trying to see what we can self-sufficiently put out there, because we are all volunteers. We take no money from it. It's just money going out on, you know, hoodies or, you know, marketing, what we're trying to do, boosting posts on Instagram, the little things like that, just every now and again. But there's been a few guys that have kind of been like, you know, come back when you've, you know, got that support. Mm-hmm. And it's like, I won't mention names and stuff like that, and I respect the decision because at the end of the day, that's their livelihood a lot of the time. So like, if they're, for TNT, for example, they've been very supportive of what we're trying to do, and Jay's been very supportive. But at the end of the day, if we were to relatively mess up, or if we, you know, if it was all a big scam or something ridiculous, it'd fall back on them, and that's, you know, that's what we're not trying to do. We're trying to make sure they know that we are trustworthy people. That's why we want to meet these people, teams call these people, answer what questions they want all the time. And it's like day or night, we are answering their questions. And, you know, getting to do podcasts like this, put faces to names instead of just a, you know, colourful logo. We can put faces to names. We can, you know, associate the names and faces with the blue hoodies. And when Ross went to Scotland, It was, you know, even though we just had our official release a week before, he was getting pulled up because people recognised the hoodies. Like Mike Angus, my dog Angus, who's quite a famous promoter, like down here in Liverpool and for Progress and Wrestle Tours and stuff like that, he recognised him. And we was on his Instagram and stuff like that. And it's like, Westy as well?
Westy is a Scottish institution, by the way.
An absolute legend.
Yes. I got Westy.
But she recognised Ross Regardes, but she also recognised the blue hoodie, which is, you know, it's mad. It really is crazy. So I think the more that we're getting out there, and the more that the blue is shining through all the sea of black t-shirts out there in pro wrestling, people are going to start associating this colour with something good, and that's what we want.
And as far as with your journeys, you talked about how you got into actual like the big scale of things of wrestling. How where were you of the indie scene? How did you get involved, both of you? How did you get into that kind of thing? I mean, for myself, I've been watching it for 12 years, so I'm a bit of an old, very old hand at these things now. But yeah, how did you get involved in the indie scene as a fan?
So I think when I moved in with my auntie a couple of years ago, I started seeing shows that were like £5 wrestling was on, and I was like, why don't I just go to that like myself, see what happens? Start meeting people, and you know, she drove me to and from the shows and stuff. Even though they were like 10 minutes away, I could have just walked it. But I just started going to stuff like that, and then I went to the Hydro show that ICW ran with Lionheart winning the belt. And at that point, I knew, I was like, okay, this is amazing. And then after that, obviously, I would think that show was open to 16-year-olds. So I was still, sort of, I was 17 at the time when I went to that one. And from there, I think Shugs was extremely close to my birthday. It was like a month. And I was like, do you know what? I'm just going to risk trying to get in. And so I went to Shugs. And that was good fun. That was when Stevie came back. So that, like, as you can imagine, I've got quite lucky with like the first kind of shows that I got to. And obviously between all that, I'd been to shows in like Wood Street and stuff like that, and a lot of sort of the local shows. And it's cool now to be able to sort of, there's more shows happening in my area now than ever before. And I'm like, if this had happened when I'd like 17, 18 years old, I'd have loved it.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And Dan, for yourself, I mean, I know the kind of Midlands up to the north scene is incredible at the moment. I'm saying that because I've no idea the geography of England. I barely know it of Scotland. But yeah, so how did you get involved in the indie scene yourself?
So my first ever time going to an independent show was at NGW in Hull, which is where I'm from. And funnily enough, Mason Ryan was on that show at the time. Like, it was before, okay, after Gladiators, before WWE. And then I never went to another indie show for like 10 years. And I don't know why. I think it's because, unlike now, it wasn't cool to be a wrestling fan in that era. So it was like, you go to wrestling, you get ridiculed for it. Now it's cool to be, it's cool again to be a wrestling fan, which is you know, amazing. But from there, let's fast forward 13-14 years, and I was like deciding what to do. I wanted to do for my stag do, and I was like, I really want to see someone get hit with a light tube. And it was, you know, I was like, let's get all my friends, because I was at that point, I'm at the point in my life where all my friends are wrestling fans now. I've surrounded myself with people that, you know, have same interests, same, like, I'm not hiding who I am anymore. I'm a great wrestling fan. I love wrestling. I love the stupidity and the pageantry and the everything about it. And, you know, I just gathered all my friends together and we had a great time. We took our own weapons. Like, my friend took a keyboard and I took fake guitars and what have you. It was just so much fun, and the greeted us with such great hospitality. And from there, I was like, right, I want to get involved in this more, because it's booming from what I understand. And I didn't understand what it was. I was like, okay, so there's NGW, there's TNT, there's Progress, there's Rev Pro, there's BWR. What else is there out there? And then I was like, okay, there's North Wrestling. And then and now every man and his dog has a wrestling promotion in the UK now. It's crazy.
For good or bad, it does seem like that, doesn't it?
but the beautiful thing is that there's no lack of talent. Mm-hmm. It's everywhere. There's talent everywhere, from Lizzie Ever, Lana Austin, Rob Drake, Charles Crowley, like I said before, Lionheart, but like, who else? Spike Trevor, Scotty Rourke, Nathan Cruz. I can list these for hours of these amazing people, kids like us. Luke Jacobs has just won the Progress title. Incredible talent. And it's like, people can use it now as a full-time work. And that is beautiful in British wrestling, is that people can go out there and get booked four times a week, make sure they can have a living, make sure they can, you know, do what they love, and maybe get to that next level. And it's beautiful to see. And I was like, I want to be a part of this. And I want to make sure that off the back of NXT UK, which some people may argue killed the British wrestling scene, we want to make sure it's rebuilt properly and with the right people. And, you know, what better way to do it than fill that gap of, like, you know, people out there, there's thousands of people out there with old wrestling toys, don't know what to do with them, collecting dust, send them to us, and we'll make more fans and get more attendance at shows, more young attendance at shows. And it's like, it just made sense. It really just made sense. So the independent scene right now is a huge place in my heart, because I've been to more independent shows in the past month than I have in my entire life.
It's wild as well, because now you're seeing people who are like, you're sort of watching, you know, a church round the corner from you are getting signed as well, you know. Mm. You know, I remember seeing Wolfgang 10 minutes, like performing 10 minutes away from where I stay, and now you see him on like TV all the time. It's like, oh my God. Like, I like seeing Joe Hendry again, you know, so locally to where we stay, even if it's over in like Edinburgh or something. You're like, he's on NXT every week now. Like, you're seeing now that sort of genuine, these people are role models to everyone, but then you could see as well, there's that genuine path now that, like, if you're into wrestling and if you're young enough and you want to give it a go now, there's so many opportunities and there's so many pathways and there's promotions everywhere that you can go to. And obviously, I would recommend coming to Girders if you're in Scotland, but that's just me being.
Girders is on my wish list. I don't keep an actual general, because I want to hit every company if I possibly can in Scotland. Yeah. But I finally ticked off Discovery Wrestling this year, and then that disco came off the list, and then Iron Girders went straight into that spot, because that's I see they did a couple of shows on Twitch, and I was like this is incredible. I love this, is my kind of wrestling. It's a little bit panto-y, a little bit of wrestling, good amount of fun, and that's what I love about what I've seen so far of the Girders shows. And you're speaking about that like there is a clear path now. I mean, I watched when Drew was in between WWE stints.
Yeah.
I saw him wrestle in Inverness, you know, in the Ironworks in Inverness, and yeah. That just blows my mind. And got to see Wolfgang there as well, and the Coffees, and it's and then Nikki Cross, Piper Niven, and Kaylee Ray, Alba Fire, all these people that you've seen over the years, and now you're getting to see them on the TV. It just inspires. The thing is though, definitely, Ross.
A lot of the imports now are coming to us. Like, we had Gresham a couple of months ago at the start of the year. And you're like, oh my God, like, people want to come and like see the British scene. It's, oh my God. And there's definitely a bit of that when you're looking at sort of, you can see now that there's a path, do you know what I mean? And that's definitely something that I looked at when I was picking a gym. I was like, well, who has sort of done that path, if that makes sense, you know? And there's countless people in Scotland. It's almost like you've got one at every gym now, which is insane. So it was just like, it almost became a non-factor at that point. You're like, everybody is so good in Scotland. Like, there are so many people that are so good. I'm like, just go to the one that's closest.
Like, absolutely. I mean, I've seen the team that are the main trainers of Girders, certainly, like your BT Gunn, your Casey, and the people that they bring through there. And it's spoiled for choice in Scotland, yeah, certainly.
We had Haskins on Monday. That was eye-opening. That was insane. Like, I took some bad shots from that one, but like, my chest was a bit worse for a while, but it was good fun.
And you mentioned all those names, Dan, as well. I mean, it's now a case where we're seeing promotions across the board teaming up with W3L and Progress as an example, because they're now on the Demand Progress Plus app. And it just shows that stuff like this, like the Hot Tag Foundation, it promotes that kind of, not collusion, that's the opposite I'm thinking of. Cohesion, that's the word, you started with C. That cohesion between promotions and people and companies and wrestlers, it just, like your tagline says, just have to reach out for the tag, and it's just a beautiful thing that you guys are doing. I won't keep you too much longer, because people will, you said yourselves, you've got like 7 days worth of podcasts, and I'm knackered if I do two in a row. I can't imagine having to do seven. I think I would probably like to just put my head into the fridge and just like sit there for a while, just let everything just cool down. But we'll do one final push and plug for the first annual Toil Rumble. I'm not going to do the all seven rules again, because that was a nightmare for me when I jinxed myself. But for you guys to plug it, why should people be donating to the first annual Toil Rumble?
Do you want to go? Or do you want me to go, Ross?
You go first. I'll chip in.
It's a difficult question. Remember as well, donate if you feel you can't donate. That's very important to start with that. But the reason why we feel you should donate now is more important than ever, because it is our inaugural year, and we are in that mindset of, we want to make this the best year, best first year that we could ever put on. And then we'll worry about how we're going to top it next year. And believe me, there's so many plans in place next year. But it's hard to get to that next level of, this is where I want to be next year. if we can't get that traction of, you know, an amazing inaugural first year. And we are trying so hard just to reach out to as many people, as many companies, as many talent, as many, you know, attending as many shows, handing out as many flyers, business cards, you know, whatever we can find to hand out that has our name on it and get our name out there and cut and our colour out there. You know, it's, we're just trying so hard to make sure that we can capture the beauty of British wrestling fans, especially British wrestling fans, because they are the heart and soul of this, of the industry, and they have such amazing love to give. And we know, and I know, and Ross knows, and I'm sure you know as well, is that I want to make sure that the next generation of young people get to experience wrestling how I experienced it, but on a brand new level. And that brand new level is just constant every day of the week, whenever you want it. You can support whoever you want, make sure you are enjoying it. And it's just such a beautiful thing to be a part of. So please, if you can, donate where you can. Make sure we have an amazing drive. We want to make sure, and it must be known, that the more that we get from your areas, the more we give back to your areas. So make sure you give and we'll feed it right back.
And just remember as well, if you've got a cupboard full of old wrestling stuff, right, you've probably had something in your case to clear out for months. So like, just remember how much things like this can have an impact on other people. Like, these things that you've got sitting about in a cupboard that your wife has been telling you to clean out for 3 months, it's going to have such a huge impact on kids and like the people that these boxes are going to, you know, whether it's a t-shirt that you don't wear anymore, like a figure that you don't use anymore that's sitting in a cupboard somewhere. Like, these donations have such a huge impact on other people, and it, like, especially coming up to a time of year where people potentially, it's almost like a competition, you know what I mean? Like, where kids go back to school after Christmas and they'll be sort of sharing what they got for Christmas. And there'll be a lot of people who don't have much that at that time of year, you know what I mean? There's a lot of people who are a lot less fortunate than us. So giving them that opportunity to go, you know, I got this really cool Jeff Hardy figure, I got this really cool Roman Reigns figure, you know, and like giving them that opportunity to show off a little bit, kind of, you know, and show their passion in that way. Because, you know, there's a lot of people going to school after Christmas and New Year with like Louis Vuitton bags and all that stuff. But if a kid's going in with an action figure that they cherish and adore, that for me is way, way, way better. So firstly, clean out the cupboard because it'll make your missus happy. Secondly, like, just imagine how happy that person's going to be in that situation. And like, you never know as well what somebody's going through at that time. So it could be something, like, that gift, that donation could be the thing that drags somebody out of their, like, a rut they're in, you know? Like I say, I know too well about being in a rut, and it can be the most silly and bizarre of things that drags you out. So, like, whatever it is, send it, please. And know that whatever impact it has, it could genuinely bring somebody out of a rut and could start this process of, you know, passion and love that is insane.
And make sure you send your donation, then. Sorry to interrupt. You do send your donation. It is important that you send a note of why you love pro wrestling and what it means to you, because that will pass on to the next generation who can read it, aspire from it, and, you know, that will develop a huge love for wrestling that we had as kids.
You mentioned a cupboard a couple of times, Ross. Please stop talking to my wife. Right, okay, so we did get one question in from Judas Gray, who I have neglected to put over in several podcasts lately, so I need to mention him at least once to stop him throwing stuff at me. Does Ross remember me from the live Joe Hendry show, How to Be a Wrestler podcast in Edinburgh? So Judas Gray.
I do, you. And what's wild as well, this one's actually coming back, because I remember way, way, way back in the day, I went to this podcast. I went to this like podcast thing and taking photos with Joe and Dave. I think that's his name. I think
Dave Conrad. Yes.
Yeah, Dave Conrad. That's the one, right? And I remember Joe was a huge inspiration for me at the time as well, and he still is now. God, and swear to God, I probably did meet him. I can't remember anything about the interaction. However, I did go to a seminar with Rampage Brown in September last year, and he was there. And genuinely, it was kind of, he'll probably hate me saying this, it was like a full circle moment now, then from like, he must have signed up to wrestling at that point, and I signed up years later, and I had my first training match with him. So like, I hadn't had a training match before wrestling Judas, and God knows how, like, some kind of fate or whatever, we get put together for that one, and he was my first ever sort of training mat, which is just wild to think about it. So big up Judas, I love Judas, and he dragged me to a good match, let's say, or like not terrible. He dragged me to a not terrible match, so I love Judas, and yes, I do very much remember him. And you know, you won't put him over, but I will. He's fantastic, isn't he? Like, it's so cool as well that that's come full circle. Like, you know, from seeing him at a Joe Hendry podcast to actually wrestling him is wild, and like, he's so good. He's so good as well, and it's annoying because I'm like, why are you that good at, like, stop it.
That's, you know, it's disgusting.
Really good, and you're like, stop being so good.
So I think that's adequately put Judas over as we wrap up the podcast. He's had to wait an hour for us to do that. But I think it gets me the analytics and the site stats, that's fine. But this has been an absolute fascinating chat. For plugging the socials, go to Hot Tag Foundation Instagram, and there's a link tree, you can find out everything. Is there anything in particular you want to plug to send people to, or is Instagram fine that has all the information that people need? Plug stuff.
The Instagram is our predominant social media platform. That's where we do most of our work. That's where we get most of our messages and contacts. The more people we get onto that, the better, because, you know, we are always 24/7 available most of the time. We're usually passed out, but 24/7, drop us a message, ask questions. We love questions. We want people to ask questions, fuels a conversation, and we love it. Ask questions, message us on. We all have access to the messages, so we can all get back to you. Whoever you want to speak to us all. We all are so excited to speak to people. The website, you know, we take great pride in the website. Get on the website, look about what you're going to find, you know, get in touch, promoters, get in touch, all that kind of stuff. Anyone who wants to get in touch, we appreciate it. And I will make sure that we will sign off, because I always forget to sign it off, with our tagline. You've just got to reach out, and please look out for the blue hoodies.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for your time. Absolutely.